the crossroads, I tried to flag a ride. Ain't nobody seem to know me. Everybody passed me by.
According to the Catholic Encyclopedia, the existence of a martyr, St. Christopher, cannot be denied, as was sufficiently shown by the Jesuit Nicholas Cerarius in his treatise on litanies, and by Milanus in his history of sacred pictures. In a small church dedicated to the martyr, St. Christopher, the body of St. Remigius of Reims was buried in 532. St. Gregory the Great, in the year 604, speaks of a monastery of St. Christopher. The Mozarabic Breviary and Missal, ascribed to St. Isidore of Seville, contains a special office in his honor. Unquestionably, St. Christopher counted among the 14 Holy Helpers, and he was among the most popular saints among the Christian people in the Near East, as well as in the Roman Catholic Church. His feast day was celebrated on May 9th and July 25th, respectively. During the Middle Ages, brotherhoods of St. Christopher devoted themselves to the care of poor travelers. St. Christopher is the patron saint of automobilists, who used to be fond of attaching a large medal with his image on their cars. It may be of interest in this connection to recall that St. Christopher ducats and dollars were coined in the 16th and 17th centuries. Many viewers of this channel didn't live through the Second Vatican Council. So, for the first part of this video, I want to show just how popular devotion to St. Christopher was prior to the council. With the introduction of automobiles in the early part of the 20th century, people started putting St. Christopher medals on their cars, since he was the patron saint of travelers. This article says that it was the widowed queen of Italy, Elena of Montenegro, who introduced the practice. But this article says that the popularity of the use of the medals started with the Queen of Spain, Victoria Eugenia of Battenberg. When American servicemen went to Europe during World War I, they went with their St. Christopher medals, and they were seeking his protection. This article says that St. Christopher was a very popular saint during the war. Many Allied soldiers in France had been wearing St. Christopher medals, imploring the great saint for his protection. And when the Americans entered the war, they too adopted the practice of wearing the medals. Pope Benedict XV recognized the importance of St. Christopher and proclaimed him to be the patron of travelers and automobilists and all ambulance, ammunition, supply, and other chauffeurs of the cars in the great lines going to and from the war front had their St. Christopher medals with them. During the war, practically all Catholic flyers carried St. Christopher medals, adopting him as the patron saint of their particular form of warfare. Eddie Rickenbacker, a famous American fighter ace during World War I, wrote, "In the breast pocket of my coat, I have carried for many years a little leather case containing a crucifix and three St. Christopher medals. The crucifix was given to me in 1917. Whenever I flew on the Western Front, I always had that case in my flying suit. I had replaced it a half dozen times." He goes on to say, "I'm not a Catholic, and aside from the sentiment connected with these things, I was certainly under no illusions as to what they could do for me. Yet, I found myself believing, as men will when everything is going to pieces, that my fate was somehow involved with them." And after the war, servicemen came home and started buying automobiles, which were becoming affordable to the common man. This article from 1927 that thousands upon thousands of automobile owners carried a St. Christopher medal somewhere in their car as an outward and visible sign that they placed their machine under the saint's special protection. Priests regularly blessed automobiles and St. Christopher medals. Roadside shrines were built for St. Christopher. This one was in Cincinnati. Another shrine was built in Delawana, where another 7,600 St. Christopher medals were blessed and distributed. Catholics told Protestants that we didn't wear medals as lucky charms, but because they have been blessed by the Church. It isn't the object that provides protection, but it's the prayers of the saint and the protection of God. There were essay contests for children on the topic, "What the St. Christopher Medal Means to Me." Radio shows were broadcast to honor St. Christopher, whom they called one of the most popular saints of the Church. The Commodore of the Queen Mary was able to dock the ship without any assistance from tugboats, and that was considered an amazing feat. When he was interviewed, he gave all credit to St. Christopher, whose medal he carried. "I looked at my St. Christopher medal and asked if I could make it, and he told me to go for it, and I did." When the story broke out, St. Christopher medals were immediately sold out in the British Isles. By 1941, St. Christopher was being called the best-known patron saint. By that time, St. Christopher medals weren't only sold at religious goods stores. They were so popular that they were also sold in dime stores and department stores. And then the United States was drawn into the Second World War. Here's a Q&A from a secular newspaper. Question: my brother is to be inducted in July. I wish to give him a St. Christopher medal. Are soldiers permitted to wear such medals? And the answer was, yes, they could. And many did, both Catholics and non-Catholics. This article says that religious articles such as St. Christopher medals were more popular than you would think with men who were in combat. It says that there was no atheism in battle stations. All the members of this air crew wore St. Christopher medals, whether they were Catholic or not. Before a mission, they would stand beside each other and ask whether they had their St. Christopher medals with them. Many pilots refused to ever take off their medals. Special St. Christopher medals were designed for pilots. Here's a photo of a pilot who downed 20 enemy planes and said that he always had a rosary and a St. Christopher medal with him. And here's a story about that very same pilot. On one day in August, he counted 27 bullet holes in his plane after shooting down two enemy planes. And just a few days later, his plane was so badly shot up by machine gun and cannon fire that it had to be junked after his forced landing, yet he was uninjured. Then toward the end of the month, he shot down 4 enemy planes, but then had to crash land. But again, he was left uninjured. 22-year-old belly turret gunner Billy Wright said that he had a charmed crew. They all wore St. Christopher medals. Captain Jack Hardwick said that he believed his St. Christopher medal kept him alive after his P-51C crash landed. It was said that the American forces went into the Battle of Midway with a fly swatter and a St. Christopher medal, and then they came out with the greatest naval victory of all time. It wasn't only the men in the trenches carrying St. Christopher medals. General Hearn wore one that had been given to him by his Methodist wife. General Kenny also carried a St. Christopher medal, even though he wasn't even Catholic. No one was claiming to be an atheist at Bataan or Guadalcanal. Many of the men wore St. Christopher medals along with their dog tags. St. Christopher medals led in popularity over even scapulars, rosaries, and crucifixes. Here's a story of a non-Catholic who was wearing a St. Christopher medal in combat. An exploding Japanese shell struck his medal, bent it out of shape, and drove it into his chest, leaving only a superficial wound. Here's the story of a soldier who attributed his safety to St. Christopher. He said that many Protestant and Jewish boys also wore it for luck. Some non-Catholics even started to carry rosaries. The tangible things of religion have the greatest appeal for fighting men. Many Protestant soldiers or sailors went into battle with St. Christopher medals in their pockets. Actress Barbara Stanwyck gave a soldier a St. Christopher medal. At the Battle of the Bulge, a Nazi bullet went through the medal. If it hadn't been for the medal absorbing part of the force of the bullet, the young soldier would have died. Nowadays, celebrities are known for almost exclusively doing things that are either evil or stupid or both. However, before the Second Vatican Council, it wasn't always that way. Errol Flynn lost his St. Christopher medal while filming on location, and then hired a guy with a landmine detector to find it. Director Howard Hawks gave his girlfriend a St. Christopher medal with 6 diamonds affixed to it. Frank Sinatra gave Toots Shore a St. Christopher medal. Lee Sullivan then entered Toots Shore's place and heaved a sigh of relief when he realized that he hadn't lost the St. Christopher medal that Bing Crosby had given to him. Then Toots Shore gave Pat O'Brien, who had played a priest in at least a couple of movies, a gold watch with a St. Christopher medal on the back of it. Then Pat O'Brien started passing out St. Christopher medals to his friends. Writer Irvin C. Cobb wore his St. Christopher medal around his wrist. Danny Kaye, who was a Jew, wore a St. Christopher medal. After the war, the soldiers came home and put their St. Christopher medals in their cars. This article said that in the days of freeways, turnpikes, and 6-lane highways, it was no wonder that St. Christopher should be one of the most popular of all saints. Even Protestants carried the medals or had them fastened to their cars. Kids wore their St. Christopher medals while competing in the soapbox derby. Gilbert Klecken, the first kid from the West Coast to win the Nationals, had a St. Christopher medal tacked to the inside of his cart and also one on his racing shirt. Frank Lenacre wore his St. Christopher medal in the derby and had his cart blessed with holy water. A St. Christopher medal was carried by the 1952 soapbox champion. Here we see Billy Boyd holding his medal before his heat in 1955. Jockeys. Many well-known jockeys wore St. Christopher medals when in action. I don't think that they mention it in the movie, but the great thoroughbred Seabiscuit always had a St. Christopher medal placed under his saddle. And the stories go on and on. Here's a story of a baby who was saved from drowning, who was clutching a St. Christopher medal while underwater. Here's the story of a man who was fired at by a gunman, where the bullet was headed for his heart, but it was stopped by a St. Christopher medal. With the Korean War, Bishop William T. Molloy issued a pastoral letter urging his priests to conduct special departure ceremonies for young men entering the armed forces. The ceremonies included the presentation of St. Christopher medals. Columnist E.V. Durling wrote that once when he was in Paris, he left his St. Christopher medal in the hotel, and on that day, without it, he became involved in a very bad automobile accident. Some auto dealers presented St. Christopher medals to each purchaser of a new or used car. It was the practice for boys to present their steady girlfriends with the St. Christopher medal. A scorching liner was said to have missed the fatal spot on Ralph Kiner by just an inch. Kiner was saved by the wearing of a new St. Christopher medal. The town of New Columbus, Pennsylvania, dedicated an entire week to St. Christopher. In the 1950s, a person wasn't prepared for a trip unless he had a St. Christopher medal or statue. St. Christopher had become part of the mainstream culture. Congressman John E. Lyle of Texas had a St. Christopher medal in his hand when a heavy piece of movie equipment fell from the gallery and just merely missed his head. We already saw that St. Isidore of Seville and Pope Benedict XV approved of devotion to St. Christopher. And here we see in 1949, Pope Pius XII presented men with the St. Christopher medal. It seems that Pope Pius must have held the saint in high regard. Here's a story of an archbishop who always carried a rosary and a St. Christopher medal that had been given to him by Pope Pius XII. But then the Second Vatican Council happened. In 1969, Pope Paul VI wiped St. Christopher from the church calendar. He said that the acts of St. Christopher were fabulous. Disagreeing with past popes and saints, Pope Paul claimed that devotion to St. Christopher wasn't even part of the Roman tradition. And he did this in such a clumsy manner that he caused doubt of the very existence of this great saint. And for this reason, I'm including this video in the Sketchy Saints playlist. St. Christopher is only sketchy to the Novus Ordo Church. Earlier, we asked whether Novus Ordo canonizations are valid. If we flip the question around, we see that the Novus Ordo Church has very little regard to the great preconciliar saints. But let's look at this at a more pragmatic level, and then we'll see just how incredibly stupid these men were. Prior to the council, Catholicism was on a trajectory to become the largest religion in the United States. As we've seen in this video, St. Christopher was a part of all that. St. Christopher medals were often the first step that Protestants took toward Catholicism. But with a stroke of a pen, Pope Paul and the Novus Ordo Church did away with all that. So it seems that evangelism wasn't even important to these silly and foolish men. And most recently, Pope Francis criticized proselytism itself. But even more criminal is how this affected Catholics themselves. Many, perhaps even most Catholics prior to the council, were cultural Catholics. They abstained from meat on Fridays. They wore their St. Christopher medals. And for these Catholics who weren't on fire with the Holy Spirit, these outward things were a great safety net for them. They kept them going to church, and these things kept them identifying as being Catholic and kept them receiving sacraments. But then the council decided to make the church more Protestant. And all these lukewarm Catholics continued going to the ridiculous sacrilegious guitar masses just for a year or so, but then they just stopped going entirely. They were told that they didn't need all the trappings of being Catholic, so they just stopped being Catholic. The Second Vatican Council abandoned all these people, and more souls may have been lost due to the council than there were ever lost to the so-called Protestant Reformation. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video. I'll be back again within a week with another one. But in the meantime, please check out my Facebook page and my Twitter page. Every day I post additional content that you won't find on this YouTube channel. And also, please pray for the church.
Stand at the crossroads, under the flag of right. Ain't nobody seem to know me. Everybody pass me by.